2015, I bought a late 2012 Mac Mini and I put 16 gigs of RAM into it back in the days when you were still allowed to. And I didn't look back for 4 years, using it pretty much every day for my video editing and voiceover work. It was a joy to use and I still have it today as a backup computer, just in case. But as time moved on, I needed more video editing power for my YouTube videos. Ideally, I would have loved to have gone for another Mac Mini, but at the time the models on offer just didn't have enough power for the price, and I really didn't want to clutter up my workspace with an external GPU. So in January 2020, I went for the 16-inch MacBook Pro. But now with the release and all the associated excitement of the Apple Silicon Macs, I couldn't help but snap up the cheapest base model of the M1 Mac Mini to find out if it's really the desktop editing replacement that I needed 10 months ago. On removing the Mac Mini from its box, it felt like greeting an old friend, as at first glance, it's pretty much impossible to tell the difference between this and my 2012 machine. It has exactly the same design and footprint. It's goodbye to space grey, for now, as this model only comes in silver. But turning to the back of the machine, we now know we are firmly in 2020. We have the familiar power switch, mains power socket, Ethernet port, two USB-C ports, a HDMI port, two old-fashioned USB-A ports, and a headphone jack. Now, there have been a few complaints about this port selection, in particular about the removal of the 10 gig Ethernet support and the lack of four USB-C ports, but I think this is just the right mix of old and new connections. Don't forget that for many people, this Mac is potentially their first time gateway machine into the Mac universe. They don't care about or use 10 gig Ethernet, and like me, they still have a number of USB-A devices knocking around that they aren't willing to jump just yet. And for my own part, I think I was most happy about the retention of the good old stable and reliable HDMI connection. And that means that this is the only M1 Mac that you can currently run two monitors from with no problems. Now, I've seen a lot of YouTube videos in the last 3 weeks complaining about how bad the Bluetooth is on this machine, but I have to say I haven't experienced any of those problems whatsoever, even though I use a mixture of third-party and Apple devices. If anything, the connections have been better, faster, and less problematic than with my MacBook Pro. The base model Mac Mini comes with exactly the same chip that you'll find in the new MacBook Air and the 13-inch MacBook Pro, with 8 GB of unified memory and 256 GB SSD. And I thought that the base model was a safe bet for several reasons. First of all, I've seen how the latest iPad Pros handle video editing with only 8 GB of RAM. So given that the M1 is based on the same type of architecture, I didn't think that video editing in 4K would be any problem. And when it comes to the 256 GB of memory, that might not sound like much, but you have to remember that I'm only using this machine for work. I'm not going to have tons of personal stuff on it like photos and music. I also edit from an external hard drive, which is much cheaper than going for Mac memory. When it comes to Final Cut Pro, I shoot all my videos in 4K, usually at 150 MB a second. I work with 2 or 3 layers of video at the most, and I do some minimal color grading. When I import my footage into Final Cut Pro, the first thing I usually have to do is create proxies so that I can edit smoothly. This takes quite a while, so I usually go and have a cup of tea or do some chores while I'm waiting. Well, no more. I couldn't actually believe it that when I first began to edit on the M1 Mini, I didn't have to make any proxies whatsoever. But now it was actually happening, and I didn't have to make any adjustments to my workflow or wait for a spinning beach ball where my cursor used to be. And all the time, even when it came to exporting, the Mac Mini remained completely silent and cool to the touch. Now, I'm told there is a fan in this machine, but after 3 weeks of daily use, I've never actually heard it kick in. Now, of course, Final Cut Pro is optimized for the Mac, but I've never been able to work in Final Cut Pro so quickly and with no worries. So my suspicions were right, this base model machine really is a revelation when it comes to video editing. As a voiceover artist, I work with Audacity, as I find it so easy to use compared to GarageBand or any other software for that matter. I'd had a few technical issues with Audacity when I first bought my MacBook Pro, as it wasn't yet fully optimized for OS Catalina, and I could only open it through Terminal for the first couple of months until it caught up. So I was expecting to have the same problems or worse with OS Big Sur, as Audacity is a third-party app. Once I opened Audacity for the first time, I was instructed to use Rosetta 2 emulation software so that it can run on an M1 machine, and within seconds I was up and running in Audacity with no problems whatsoever. The only other third-party app I use is Affinity Photo, and that too seems to be running at lightning speed with no problems. Now, I don't use DaVinci Resolve or Premiere Pro, but if YouTube reports so far are to be believed, they are also running absolutely fine, and by early next year, they too will be optimized for the M1 chip with no need for emulation software. So, do I regret buying a 16-inch MacBook Pro in early 2020? Well, no, I bought what I thought was the best computer for my needs at that time. And even though I knew that Silicon Macs were coming, neither I nor anyone else knew exactly when or whether they'd actually live up to the hype. Fortunately though, the M1 Mac Mini does just that. Free from Intel chips at last, Apple can now deliver the speed, power, and sheer convenience of their phones and tablets in an entry-level desktop. And even if you don't use intensive programs for photo and video editing, you'll be blown away by this Mac as an everyday workhorse, with everything you do just happening so much faster. For years I've thought that if Apple ever lowered their prices to PC level, they'd rule the world in terms of hardware. Well, with the power-to-price ratio that Apple now have on offer, that's exactly what could happen. Whether you make 5 to 10 minute YouTube videos like me, or you're looking for your first video editing desktop, I wouldn't hesitate to recommend the base model of this machine. But if you're not desperate for a new machine or simply can't spare the cash right now, why not wait until the spring or summer, when any issues that people do have running M1 Macs are well and truly addressed by Apple? And bear in mind that this machine is what is notoriously known as first generation technology. Things can and will only get better.